welcome to the 2020 Tarvin Food and Music Festival tour of Tarvin, looking at some of its more historical sites. I'm Peter Craig. I've lived in the village for 40 years and I've always been interested in its history, so I hope to be able to share some of that with you by going round the top end of the village to look at the market stands area and the school and the church. We'll have a look up there and see what we can learn about the village's past from these places. Right, we're now at the market stands. A very green and quiet area of the village, but once upon a time it was an absolute bustling area of all sorts of things were going on. All the fine granite buildings down in the square and the prosperity that they reflect, a lot of that prosperity came from the business that was transacted right here, all around this grassy area, and where there are now lots of houses and Aberdeen Terrace and Strachan Cottages, right up towards the school, all that was part of the market stands. In fact, that part of the area is on the old maps as the cattle market, but buying and selling was what this area was about, and fairs and markets were held here regularly. Markets were held every week, and this dates back to as far back as 1683, when Tarvin became a borough of barony. It was called, and that gave it the right to hold weekly markets. So people would come from all over Upper Deeside, Upper Donside, and they would head for Tarvin as virtually the only place where you could buy and sell things on a large scale, and it had a frequency of markets which was much greater than anywhere else in the area. So it was a market town, and as well as the weekly markets, there were much bigger events called fairs, and there were six or seven of these during the year. There would be a horse fair at a particular time, there would be a sheep fair, cattle fair, and these were occasions when crowds and crowds of people would have descended on the village, a bit like the Food and Music Festival today, but people bent on enjoying themselves, but also treating this as a big shopping spree. They would come to get all the shopping that they required for the next few months, and market days were occasions for great merriment, lots of social interaction, and I have to say they had a history, a scandalous reputation for degenerating into drunken brawls at the end of the day, when folk from surrounding villages and communities would battle each other, literally hand-to-hand battles all around the area, and there's quite a few stories of that. I'd really love to see a time team or dig or some excavation in this area, because if you think about it, with people buying and selling things for 400 or 500 years in this spot, there must be an absolute treasure trove of stuff just under the turf we're standing on. This area has history that isn't all that far below our feet. And we're now going to move over to a corner over there which has a particular story to tell. It's called Ailsa, although before that it was known as the Smiddy. This is an area that would have been an absolute focus for the village. You can imagine the bustle and hustle of going on here, with farmers coming and going with their horses, bringing implements to the fair, buying implements, the smith, the blacksmith and his team all working away, the fire roaring, people coming and standing around and gossiping and smoking and passing judgment on all the issues of the day. This would have been a meeting place for the men of the village, I suspect, would have gathered here just for the warmth of the fire, if nothing else, in winter time. So the smithy was a key place. And of course, right on the market, on market days, it would have been particularly busy. But not only was there a smithy here, but there was one just over there, and we're going to pan round to the village farm over there, and that corrugated iron roof over there is another very old building that has a story to tell. This is another smithy, not very far away from the last one, and it was probably run by the same family. There was a family of Bays. There was five generations of Bays, most of them Alexander Bay, who were blacksmiths, and one of the sons eventually took over this as a smithy. Not sure if the smithy was actually in this tin-roofed building or in the part of the village farm steading, but this end is certainly on the maps as a smithy, and smithies were an integral part of the whole economy. All the farmers from roundabout would have brought their horses for shoeing and their implements for repairing, as I said before. This is a very old building because it's way below the current street level. If you look at the doorway there, it's sunk down because in the years since it was in use, the road has been built up. But this is one of the oldest buildings in Tarland. And one of the things that I should have mentioned about the market stands that was a very important aspect of what it was used for was a feeing market. Twice a year, farm servants would come into Tarland to make their contracts with farmers and other employers in the area that would bind them for their employment for the next 6 months. So feeing markets were very important social occasions, and they were part of the big fairs that took place on the market stands here. So people's livelihoods were also determined in this spot. We're now at the school, which was, it appears on maps going back a long way, and the present building was built, or it was started in 1894, and in 1894, this block here with the turret, the single turret, and the schoolhouse, they were built at that time, and they replaced a school that was on this site before that. In 1894, version of this building, there was actually a projecting building in front here, which was basically the cloakrooms for the pupils, and there had been a boys' side and a girls' side, and the whole school was contained in that block. In 1914, by which time the village population was growing considerably, they had to add another block, and so they've made a very similar design, set back. And it too had cloakrooms jutting out the front. Then, later still, in 1935, there was a major renovation, and they took away the cloakrooms here and built this extra block, again, very, very similar style. And on the guttering, you can actually see the date 1935. So that was three main events for actually constructing the school and as it gradually expanded. And then after that, we're now into the 1950s, they built the school hall with its very distinctive copper roof and the kitchens, and the staff room, I think, was added even later than that. So that's a fairly big extension in the 50s or 60s, somewhere thereabouts, I'm not sure. I'll have to ask somebody that locally that knows, or the members even. But that school was the junior secondary school for this area, and had something like up to, I think, 166 pupils at one point. So big school, and an important part of the community. And when it was built, it was completely out of the village. All these houses round about didn't exist then, so if you wanted to come to school, you had to leave the village, come up the hill to the school, and then go home again afterwards. And round the back of the school, there were garden plots, very clearly marked on the old maps, where the pupils were obviously introduced to gardening and growing things and learning about crops, etc. That site later became the site of the village recreation hall, but that's another story for another day.
Okay.
As well as a school being built up here, there was a bank built down there. We'll just have a wee look at the back of the bank. It was the Union Bank, and it was also a very important part of the village economy, because that's where all the money from the fairs and the markets all was banked in this building. So we're at the old Union, and the large building down here was originally a farm, and then in the early 1800s it was extended considerably and turned into a bank. It became the first bank in the village, very important part of the facilities for the village. And then in the back here, hidden in all the trees, there's actually a steading, which is a listed building, and it has all the original internal fitments of a stable and all the facilities you need for feeding horses and cattle and things. That steading is still largely intact, I believe, and as I say, is a listed building. We're now going to go along to the end of School Road, back down into the village, and just have a look. Believe it or not, there is another school which has a history of its own, and we'll have a look at that one as well. This is a little detail that is very easily overlooked, but the wooden post that holds up the post box is actually the post that was originally for the village street lighting. There were about a dozen of these posts around the village, but this is one of only two that remain, and paraffin lamps used to be hung from them and lit every night and pumped up, and there are people in the village who still remember doing that as kids, to go around and pump up the paraffin lights that lit the village before electricity came in the early 1950s. We're now going to go down to the other school that I mentioned already. This building is on the map as the female school, and its history is that it was constructed by the Countess of Aberdeen round about 1870 in memory of her husband, the Earl of Aberdeen, who had died just a year or two earlier. The original school that we looked at, that was built in 1894, was for boys and girls, but prior to that, if you were a girl, you'd have come here for your education, but you'd have had to pay for it, so it was a very different school from the other one. We're moving along the road, just beyond this old female school, to the church, St. Molloig's Church, which also has a bit of history and reflects the development of the village in quite a few different ways. This is St. Molloig's Church, which was built in 1869, and you might be surprised, it looks like a complete church, but originally the part with the steeple, this end here, didn't wasn't part of the church. It was added 20 years later in 1889. But it is worth noting that Tarland always has had a church. There are Vatican documents going back right to the 1100s which mention a church in Tarland, and it's mentioned in all the centuries thereafter. And that church would have been down where the Old Kirk is at the village square. The Old Kirk that we see today, the ruins of it, are from the 1700s, but way back before that there were kirks on that site, Roman Catholic churches originally, and this church here was built when the village was prospering. It was another sign of the village expanding and prospering and requiring new accommodation and a better church, and this is a statement of the village's grandeur. It's a huge church for the size of village, and it's a very attractive one as well. So you can go to church here for your spiritual benefit, or if you're wanting more physical exercise, you can go straight across to the golf course on the other side of the road, and it too has a bit of history to tell us. Tarland is very proud of its golf course. It was designed by one of the most famous golf course designers of his age, old Tom Morris, and in 1908 it was opened as a nine-hole course, and it was the Earl of Aberdeen who had recently built what is now called the Astrian House, was then the House of Cromar. He wanted a golf course and had this constructed to the very highest standards. It was then open to the community and a golf club was formed sometime after 1908. But if you go along the golf course, along the higher parts of the course, there is evidence of history going much, much, much further back than that. There are rig and furrow traces on the higher parts of the fairway towards the Lastrian House, where you can see the big ridges and hollows where they used to plough using 12 oxen ploughs, huge ploughs, and you can even see some of the curved shapes at the end of the rigs where they turned the oxen. Turning a big team of oxen was quite a big task to do and requires space, but you can see all of that as you're playing golf on the Tarland golf course, which takes you neatly into the full circle of Tarland's history. This golf course is the final stop on this part of the tour, this year's tour. There are lots of other places in Tarland of interest, but it's interesting that the golf course itself has evidence of history going way back before we played golf and had leisure time to do that. The people used to grow their crops to feed themselves on the land that is now the Tarland golf course, and if you go out golfing, your ball bounces up and down on these old rigs and furrows, reminding us of Tarland's very distant past. Thank you for joining us on this virtual tour of part of Tarland's history. There's lots more to see and lots more to look at. We can do it again some other time. Thank you for joining us.